Good morning, church, and thank you for joining us today in worship. We want to take a moment to just say thank you for choosing to be with us at First United Methodist Church in Maryville, Tennessee. No matter where you're joining us from, whether it be across the street or across the country, feel free to let us know how you're doing. Check in with us if you're on Facebook or YouTube. We also would like to encourage you, as we're starting to regather in person again, feel free to stay connected with our social media platforms and our church website. Those will be the best way to stay up to date with information about the regathering. We want to let you know that we are going to continue to have an online presence as we move forward so that everyone can feel safe and comfortable as we work to grow closer to Christ. Now let's take a moment and prepare ourselves for worship.
Now, friends, we affirm our faith with a modern affirmation. I will begin and then we will join in together. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
Our opening hymn this morning, How Can We Name a Love? A very familiar melody, so please join me in singing.
Now, friends, let us go to our God in prayer. Almighty and gracious God, no matter where we are this day, outdoors or indoors, we are ready to worship you. As we have begun this new month, we are ready to go and to do. And we are ready to live out our call to love your children, to love our neighbors. God, help us to find ways this month that we can go and do. Help us to find ways in which we can share your love and your grace and your hope with this world. Whether it is through our go-do collections, through writing cards to local schools, or taking time to just pray for the ministries that support the poor and the vulnerable in our community, God. Help us to go and to do. Help us, gracious Lord, to find ways to be kind. Remind us that we are your hands and your feet in this world, and we are your representation. And so when people are looking at us, they are trying to see you. And so help us in all our ways, in what we do and what we say, what we type, and how we are. Let us be a true reflection of you, a true reflection of your love, a true reflection of your grace. And Almighty God, when we need to receive your love, when we need to receive your grace. Open our hearts. Open our hands. Open our minds so that we might take that moment to receive. And then, Lord, move us with compassion to continue to go and to do. Move us with compassion. Move us with love. Move us. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, the one who calls us to go out, to make disciples, to love our neighbors, to share your life and light and love, we pray. And now together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, I'm here at our Friendship Pavilion, where the church council met this past Monday evening. One great celebration of that meeting was of the financial health and the ongoing generosity and faithfulness and stewardship of our congregation. So this morning, as we prepare to worship God with tithes and gifts and offerings, as always, we offer up our thanks to God for all of the blessings and all of the resources that God entrusts to our care. But I also want to thank you for your faithfulness and generosity in sharing those resources for the ministry of the church. As we worship God together now, will you please join with me in prayer? Holy God, we believe that you are the giver of all good gifts, so we bow with thanksgiving before you as we thank you for the resources, for the money, for the possessions that you entrust to our care. And we pray that you'll grant us wisdom as we earn, as we save, as we invest, as we spend, and as we share. Now consecrate these gifts that we offer before you, and we pray that your Holy Spirit would move upon them to make them holy and to empower them to share the love and the grace and the good news of Jesus Christ our Lord in our community and world. And it is in the precious and powerful name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Friends and neighbors, if we were living together in normal circumstances, this first Sunday in September would be the day that we would honor one of First United Methodist Church's favorite new traditions, the All-Church Tailgate Sunday. We'd gather together outside where we would enjoy not only the beauty of each other's fellowship and presence and faces, but we would enjoy the beauty of God's creation around us. We'd share worship together. We'd share fellowship and food together. We might even share friendly rivalry together, and that's why I'm wearing my Emory and Henry College shirt this morning. As part of the worship that we shared, we would challenge each other to remember that September, in another of First United Methodist Church's traditions, is a time to go and do. So we would lift up and highlight the opportunities in the weeks to come to share, to serve, to love our neighbors. But as we all know, COVID-19 has had a disruptive effect on many of our rhythms and routines and traditions. The church is no exception. But we believe that our faith triumphs over the obstacles. So I'm so grateful that we have the opportunity in some way to celebrate our All-Church Tailgate Sunday here virtually online. In fact, I tried multiple times to record this sermon in the outdoor setting here at the church, but I was distracted by all the surrounding noise of airplanes and lawnmowers and of construction vehicles and even the wind. I was afraid that it might be distracting to us all. But I'm still grateful that God gives us this opportunity to be together virtually online. I'm even more grateful that today, for the first time in 6 months, we're able here to have in-person worship opportunities outdoors. Aren't we grateful to God for that gift? And we're grateful that COVID doesn't get the final word. And we're also grateful that even though it doesn't resemble closely years in the past, we're still able to make September a time to go and do. I hope you read this past week's Church Bell newsletter to find ways in which you can go and do and share and serve in the month ahead. In the spirit of going and doing, I'd like to read a gospel passage today from Luke's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37, in which Jesus Christ himself actually says the words, "Go and do." Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." Jesus said to him, "You've given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them, and then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Now which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The lawyer said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." Will you please pray with me? Gracious God, in every season of our lives, but especially in a season in which we seek to go and do, please enable us to see with the eyes of Jesus Christ, to love with the heart of Jesus Christ, to serve with the hands of Jesus Christ, and empowered by the grace and strength of Jesus Christ, to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And we offer this prayer in his powerful and precious name. Amen. Let's begin this sermon by asking ourselves the question that the lawyer asks Jesus: "And who is my neighbor?" And as you're envisioning And as you're imagining your neighbors, follow that question with a second question. How do I love my neighbors? Jesus teaches the lawyer and teaches us in several ways, I believe, through this parable, what it means to love our neighbors. And one of the first lessons that I learned from Jesus in this passage is that love for neighbors is not something you define, it's something you demonstrate. We don't know much about this lawyer. In fact, we don't know much about any lawyer. The word lawyer only shows up once in the Gospel of Luke, and it only shows up twice in all the Gospels, at least here in the New Revised Standard Version. But we get a hint from Jesus' interaction with him that he knows very well the law of Moses, those first five books of the Bible. We know from the way Luke, the Gospel writer, describes him that he has a motive when he enters into this conversation with Jesus. There in verse 25, notice that he stands up to test Jesus. This word test, ekperazo, is a word that shows up once before in the Gospel of Luke, back in chapter 4, when Satan is out in the wilderness tempting Jesus. And just after Satan tempts Jesus to throw himself down from the pinnacle of the temple, Jesus responds, "Do not put the Lord your God to the test." Ekperazo. Jesus sees this lawyer as entering into that kind of verbal wrangling, that kind of defining, that kind of describing that Satan enters into when he offers Jesus an interpretation of Scripture, saying that God will send his angels to lift you up. Jesus seems to think that that kind of thing is vexing to God. And maybe one of the lessons that we learn early on is that in all of our efforts to define and to describe, all those efforts that distract us from actually demonstrating love, maybe Satan, the obstacle, is doing Satan's job of getting in our way. And look at all the defining and describing that the church has tried to do over the centuries, even over the millennia. We've divided from each other because of our different understandings. We've demonstrated to the world that we can't live together in the same denomination or in the same church, and so we haven't demonstrated love for each other, much less for the world around us. So maybe that's key to our understanding, that love for neighbors is not something to be defined, but to be demonstrated. And the lawyer is probably doing what comes very naturally to him in trying to define precisely what love for neighbors actually means, but he's also probably trying to pigeonhole Jesus into a particular understanding of neighbor that can and will be used against him later down the road. And this is not something that's happening for the first time as this lawyer has a conversation with Jesus. Way back in Leviticus chapter 19, we get that understanding of neighbor as someone who is like you, someone who is your relative, someone who is your kinsperson from one of the tribes of Israel. But then a few verses later in that very same chapter, that definition of neighbor extends out to include the foreigner or the alien who is among you. Now, when the Hebrew Scriptures are translated into Greek just a few decades before Jesus' time upon the earth, those translators chose to define those foreigners and aliens as proselytes, foreigners and aliens who are trying to become Israelites and Jews. So you see there's three possible understandings of neighbor. The person who is an Israelite like you, the person who is a foreigner and an alien among you, or the person who is a foreigner and an alien among you who wants to be like you. Probably the lawyer prefers one of those first or third definitions, and he wants to see if Jesus would expand it out perhaps to include those foreigners and aliens. It's sensible because in the preceding chapter, we find that Jesus has spent some time in Samaria, and we know throughout the Gospels that Jesus is known to wander beyond Israel and beyond Judea to encounter people that he treats with grace and love. So this lawyer is probably trying to define, and don't we imitate the lawyer in so many ways? Don't we struggle to define who is our neighbor? And honestly, we probably go by one of those first or third definitions, don't we? The people who naturally come to our minds when we think about that concept of neighbor are the ones who are like us, or at least the ones who are trying to be like us. It's more difficult for us to see that person who is a foreigner or an alien to us as our neighbor. Think of some of the things we say. When God gave the commandment to love your neighbor as yourself, God didn't know my neighbor, we say. And then we'll use these vague, generic, sweeping statements like, I love everyone. I just don't like everyone. That leads us very well to a second understanding that I gather from this passage. And that is that love for neighbor is not something to be felt. It's something to be done. No doubt this lawyer probably understands himself to be a person who loves his neighbor. He may be using a very narrow definition of neighbor, but he probably, as a person who is devoted to the law of Moses and to teaching it to others, understands himself to be a fairly righteous person in the eyes of God. He probably takes very seriously his responsibility to do the will of God. So he probably thinks of himself as a person who loves his neighbor, at least as he understands his neighbor. He and Jesus probably agree that the priest and the Levite in the parable probably understand themselves to be people who love their neighbors. The priest, on behalf of his neighbors, every time that he's in the temple, offers up their sacrifices to reconcile them to God. He performs a very important function on behalf of his neighbors. And so does the Levite, who is an assistant in some way in the temple worship. They probably see themselves as people who feel a great love for their neighbors, whatever their understanding of neighbor is. Jesus, the lawyer, the priest, and the Levite would probably least suspect that the Samaritan would feel love for that Jewish man lying on the side of the road. There's a traditional, long-standing hostility and enmity between the Samaritans and the Jews. And we see that described at several points during the Gospels. But we hear that beautifully described in John chapter 4 when the Samaritan woman says to Jesus, we're even different in our understandings of what's the most appropriate place and way to worship God. And they differed from each other, and the Jews were very condescending toward the Samaritans. The Samaritans thought that the Jews weren't as strict in their devotion to things like the Sabbath. The Samaritans resented the Jews because they took such a condescending view of them. So there's this long-standing hostility. Doubtful that the Samaritan looked upon a Jewish man feeling love. But that might be Jesus' point. It's not what you feel, it's what you do. And doesn't he say that twice? Look at the scripture that we've read together. In verse 28, just after the lawyer says, loving your neighbor as yourself is part of what God desires of us if we want to inherit that eternal life. And so Jesus responds, you've given the right answer. Do this. Poie is the Greek word. Do this and you will live. Love is something that you do. And then later, after Jesus tells the parable and asks the lawyer, which of these was a neighbor? The lawyer responds, the one who showed mercy. And in the final verse of this passage, in verse 37, Jesus says, go and do, poie, do likewise. So love for neighbor is not something that you feel. It's something that you do. And the other thing that I believe that Jesus illustrates in this passage is that love for neighbor is not something we do to preserve ourselves. It's a risk-taking love on behalf of the other. Love for neighbor is not self-preservation. Love is risk-taking on behalf of the other. The word for love, both for God and for neighbor, throughout the Gospels, in fact, throughout the whole New Testament, is the Greek word agape. Centuries ago, St. Thomas Aquinas, one of the great fathers of our Western Church, defined agape as willing the good of the other. Agape is not about what I feel, but agape is about what I am willing to do for the good of another. Now, in this parable that Jesus shares, there's plenty of risk-taking, but there's also plenty of self-preservation. One element of risk-taking is in the setting. Notice that Jesus begins the parable by saying that a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. That's literal. Jerusalem is at an elevation of about 2,500 feet above sea level. Jericho, down in the Dead Sea Valley, is about 800 feet below sea level. Notice that from 2,500 feet above to 800 feet below is it's a loss of elevation of 3,300 feet. And the distance from Jerusalem to Jericho is about 12 to 15 miles. So imagine losing 200 feet of elevation every mile of the trip on average. Here in Blount County, we have our very own Tale of the Dragon, that winding, curving road through the mountains. The road from Jerusalem to Jericho is very much the same. Switchbacks and curves because of that loss of elevation, or if you're coming from Jericho to Jerusalem, that dramatic gain of elevation of about 200 feet per mile. So it's a dangerous place. You never know what lies around the next curve, and in some of those valleys the sun is obscured, and so it can be a dark place where your eyes have to adjust from sunlight to darkness. And maybe in one such place these bandits have fallen upon this poor man. Well, not only is it a dangerous place, but it's a particularly dangerous place for a Samaritan, because it's way down in the southern kingdom of Judea, far away from Samaria. And if anyone is going to be preyed upon in that kind of dangerous setting, wouldn't you imagine that it would be the foreigner, the one who is resented because of his ethnicity, because of his tribal affiliation? Maybe that's the reason that the priest and the Levite don't offer help. Maybe they believe that the wounded man is already dead. Maybe they're fearful that the bandits are still close by. But for whatever reason, it seems they're acting out of self-preservation. Notice that in each case, Jesus says, when the priest or the Levite saw him, they passed by on the other side. So it was an intentional act. Notice that when the bandits have taken his clothing and beaten him almost to death, they go away from him. So there are a lot of people going away from this man. He represents danger, perhaps, to the priest and the Levite. He represents, perhaps, a disruption of their livelihood. If he is dead and they touch a dead body, they can't then serve in the temple. But for whatever reason, they're preserving themselves. Whether it's in fear for their livelihood, whether it's in fear for their ritual purity, whether it's in fear for their well-being, they choose themselves and pass by on the other side. But this Samaritan, who is in a dangerous place and who is already further jeopardized because of who he is, doesn't pass by, does not go away. Jesus describes him as coming near to the person. And not only that, he follows it up with another phrase just a little bit later. He went to him. The Samaritan is the one who goes to the man rather than walking away from him. And you see that he's moved to pity. Move is an action verb. The Samaritan knows that love is not something to be felt. It's something to be done. So he does. He takes a risk by putting him on his own animal. Jesus is quick to specify that. Now his getaway vehicle is occupied. If he does run into danger, he can't get away quickly because his animal is burdened now with this wounded man. He takes him to an inn. Now imagine this stranger of a hated people walking into an inn with a wounded man who might have relatives, or at least might have people who know him, or at least have people who consider him their neighbor there in the inn. That's risk-taking. The Samaritan occupies the inn to care for him. There's some expense, but he takes out 2 denarii, known as the daily wage, and pays the innkeeper to further care for the man. Now, if that's the daily wage of a worker, a field worker, a common worker, a fisher in Israel or Judea at that time, it's important that we make a connection. According to the 2019 Bureau of Labor Statistics, the average daily income for someone who works in farming or forestry or manufacturing or production or repair is somewhere around $156 per day. Now imagine 2 daily wages. In our culture today, that would be about $312. That's risk-taking. To to give away $312 to pay for a man might mean that the Samaritan doesn't have the resources that he'll need for the rest of his travel or journey. That's a significant gift to give to an absolute stranger. It's risk-taking. And not only that, but he promises to come back, almost hands the innkeeper a blank check and says, I'll pay for whatever more you spend. That's risk-taking. And the Samaritan probably did not begin that day by saying, where is an opportunity for me to go and do? He simply allowed himself to be moved by the need of another. He exercised poie. He would do. He exercised coming near when someone was in need rather than walking away. Well, in this month of September, there are concrete opportunities for us to go and do. But maybe in those moments of life when we least expect it, when we're simply traveling along the way, there will be opportunities for us to go and do in the life of another. Maybe like the lawyer, our definitions need to become demonstrations. Maybe like the lawyer, what we feel needs to translate into what we do. Maybe like the lawyer, maybe like the Levite, maybe like the priest, you and I need that subtle reminder that we are not called to preserve ourselves in this agape love of God and of neighbor, but we're called to take risks, to will the good of another. So as Jesus says to the lawyer, maybe Jesus says to you and me today, as we're traveling along life's road and we find that person that everyone else might want to walk by and everything within us might tell us to preserve ourselves by walking by too. Maybe there's the opportunity not to define, but to demonstrate. Not to feel, but to do. Not to hold on to that desire to preserve ourselves, but to take a risk for the good of another. In this month and always, may you and may I go and do likewise.
Our closing hymn this morning is the great gospel song, Oh, How I Love Jesus. We will sing all three verses, but Duane will give us a wonderful interlude after verse 2. Let's enjoy together. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love, who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
Friends and neighbors, it's been a blessing and gift for us to share this time of worship together. So now go in the name, in the grace, in the peace, in the mercy of Jesus Christ, and do. Demonstrate His love to our neighbors, to all of our neighbors, and share love generously, extravagantly, even recklessly, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.